জয়ন্ত, জেম কাপুর, সমরজিৎ, অনিন্দ প্রেজেন্টেশন। ওকে, নাও টুডে আই উইল স্পিক অন এ ভেরি স্পেসিফিক সাবজেক্ট। ইউ নো, উই হ্যাভ গন ওভার দি কানেকশন বিটুইন সোসাইটি, লিভিং কালচার, প্রিজার্ভ কালচার, ওপেন ক্লোজ মিউজিয়াম, উই হ্যাভ গন ওভার দ্য হোল লট। My submission today is only as a visitor to this place for the last 50 years, if I may put it, I am 63, so maybe a little less. And then as a student who used to come to the curator, the honorable curator, Nishit Ranjan Rai, that's early mid-70s, and then as someone who messed up the place. Now, I have this same question that all of us keep asking: why do we waste our museum collections? Why do we waste opportunities? I'll put it like this, let's cut over. India has the world's richest collection. I mean, there's no doubt about it, because we have compared it, there's no hyperbole about it. From the third millennium BCE, when you talk of richness, so what the hell, where do we posit third millennium BCE? It's as old as the old kingdom of Egypt. That's as old as that. And Sumer, Mesopotamia. So China would be coming a little later, 1500 BC. So we have a 1500 year lead over them. That's the only thing we have a lead other than the Nobel Prize. We got it about 99 years ahead of them. Okay. And pre-Greek. European civilization starts with Greece, Mycenaean. So that puts where we are in terms of collection civilization. But, and let me go over quite a few, just a few iconic pieces. This is Buddha's relic, 3rd century BC, not on display, very fragile. It's a replica that we display, but this is there. Any of the Buddhist countries would give their right arm to get this. We have in the Indian Museum, the Gandhara Buddha, 3rd century BC, Greek style, among the earliest, because it started about 400 years before. We have, I'm just a few collections, just to keep your mind off from very serious stuff. Remains of Harut, it's entirely uprooted in the true European style. When you saw the Pergamon, where they completely uprooted the whole thing without any thought of what it would look like, and transported it to some other museum. The Elgin marbles, this was done in the true style. But let's be honest, it helped us, several generations of students, to understand without taking the trouble to go to Bharat. Unique walk through history, outstanding details. Try to take a second look at it if you can. You have seen it in the past. Go and study it once again if you have some time. 2 hours is all you need to renew your contacts with your own civilization. Then I'm talking the dancing girl of Mohenjo-daro. This is in the 5th century BC. Actually, I would put it a little earlier, but that's what they say. This is the last stage of Mohenjo-daro. It's the oldest, one of the oldest artifacts we have. Then we go on to the National Museum, Harappan pot, 2nd century, among the oldest specimens. Each symbol out there, it didn't come out very well, has a cultural meaning. Each one can be a magnificent exhibition in its own right. This is Ganga on Makara. Makara is a crocodile here. Part Greek, part Indian. Synthesis of cultures where the clothing and the folds are from the Greek heritage. Moving fast on, National Museum has Buddha with 6 disciples, a 3rd, 4th century CE, and this was taken up by Orenstein in the first 3 decades of last century. This Orenstein collection's 10% is with the British Museum and with the Germans. They have the entire international Dunhuang project built on it. 90% of the collections lying in the National Museum. They were in crates till 2 years before. I'll tell you why we mess up. This is Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, that's anyway, call it Prince of Wales Museum. This is the Dhyani Buddha, seated Buddha. is from Mirpur Khas, Pakistan. Again, it will take a long time to explain why it is so. Prince of Wales again has the shield of Akbar with gold. If you go back to which are the battles on which Akbar carried this, it itself is enough to engage you. It's got unique gold work. Prince of Wales again has the Anwari Suhaili. It was commissioned, it's one of the tales for the Panchatantra, commissioned by Akbar from a Hindu repertoire of tales. It's an excellence of the Mughal atelier, and it carries with him the living synthesis of Indian history. I'm coming now, Salar Jung, Parasmath, Kakatiya dynasty, 12th century, black basalt. Like the Palas. In fact, we have seen so much black basalt in India, in Bengal, in the Indian Museum. It's the same period when we got on to black basalt. After this, sculpture would stop for about 300 years. With the arrival of Islam, it would stop, except in the south where it continued. I mean, these are the landmarks. Black basalt is one of the hardest stones to work with, and some of the finest carvings have been done. Salar Jung also incidentally moves away from the old style museum of antiquities to what is called the European Decorative Arts, European Western Decorative Arts. Then you move on again to another piece in Salar Jung. This is a must see in Salar Jung. This is a two-headed statue, so you have a mirror behind. Mephistopheles and Margareta. It's a French, it's a star attraction. One side you have the devil and the other side, this is the torment of Dr. Faust, with the girl who teased him and the devil who tormented him. Salar Jung also has his veiled Rebecca. If you have seen it, you will see the fineness. I still can't understand how they did it. How can you have a veil of stone? 19th century, it's a very delicate veil. Each piece, this is Victoria Memorials, I would rate it one of the finest collections. Majmoul Bahrain, that is the confluence of two oceans or two seas. Dara Shikoh, 1615 C. It's a piece on this similarity between Sufism and the Vedanta. Symbol of plurality. The net result is Dara Shikoh would lose the throne. But this carries a tale. This is Bharat Mata. Again, one of the prized collections of Victoria Memorial, Avanindranath, 1905, as Lakshmi, the first symbolization personifications of Mother India. What Nargis would take over after this. And then Indira Gandhi, I think. Anyway. So this is the treaty between Mirzafar and the British, works of Jamini Roy. I'm just mentioning this. Now, how are treasures acquired? Point one, theft. This is a very interesting book. Try to read it up if you can. Jacqueline Yalop, Magpie, Squirrels and Thieves. Magpie is a bird that invariably steals anything within the sight. Squirrels have this awful habit of picking up small artifacts and taking it to their homes. And thieves are thieves. How Victorians collected the world. It's a strong indictment, but let me be frank, if you go through it, no. Theft is only one of the methods. Theft is a rather harsh indictment. It's built by passion and a sense of history. That's all. Right now, as I'm talking to you, there are scholars from certain European and American countries who are moving around the old shops, musical instrument shops, and picking up the last specimen. They are open for you. You could have picked it up. Tagore's Gitanjali's manuscript was open for about 60 years. Harvard picked it up. You didn't pick it up. Why is it that? So instead of getting into how much do we show? Next question. These are one of the small advantages I have of being in that museum items in thousands. So Indian Museum has 1,08,000, we show 6%. National has 208,000, they show 21%. Salar Jung has 46,000 items, they they show 30%. VMH, Victoria Memorial Hall, has 28,000, they show 10%. Allahabad Museum has 72,000, they show 25%. Prince of Wales, or Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, has 60,000, they show 15%. I guess this will tell you the story. Now, this is not a story which is particular to India. It's there in many parts of the world, except that 6% is an awful figure, is a terrible figure. It has to be more. And then do we circulate the exhibits? The answer is almost no. So we get stagnated at that figure, and the treasures of the nation are withheld from it because of the system. Now, what is the system all about? But why is it so? Cultural issues, rule bound, financial constraints, space constraints, expertise, inventory, leadership. No, I've gone over every possible question that was thrown at me, and I left the task incomplete, unsuccessful, hoping that there are others who can take over. Cultural issues. This is one issue we never ponder about. Never. Indian culture is against preservation. Everything has a life. After that, it is consigned to the flames or immersed. Think about it. It is thrown away. The moment a person dies, his personal artifacts are given off elsewhere. We don't keep impure things in the house. Islamic rule, we don't keep impure things. That is the mind, genetic mindset. Mage, kar, ajibade, kun mona manushe dinis. That we have that mentality running behind us. So we are not prolific collectors. Islamic rule brought in the Toshakhana, but that was more of palace collections than of museums. British imported the idea of museums. 1784 Asiatic Society, 1814 the Indian Museum, William Jones. So my first submission is that there is a cultural mindset that is working against preservation. But then 200 years of British rule should have rectified, or should have, let us say, offset some of the cultural rule bound. Most large museums are central and state government, terribly bound by rules. I can't help it. The best of curators, best of directors, I placed Goenka as one of them, not because he's sitting in front of me, but they would always suffer from this terror of CBI, CVC, CAG. Once you are stung, you are finished. Therefore, there are people like him, before him, who would not do a single thing, because if you don't do anything, you don't do anything wrong. Then comes the ministry's diktats. Every undersecretary thinks he knows the subject. Procedures and precedents matter most. Performance provokes jealousy. Anybody who has performed knows that he provokes jealousy. Expansion projects take up to 20 years, maybe 30. The National Museum's expansion project is now 21 years old. Victoria Memorial's NXC is around, I joined the Victoria Memorial Board in 2002. We started then, or before that. So it's about 13 years old now. Even bulbs and galleries. Now these guys have got the special lighting. Before this, if you wanted to change the bulbs and galleries, they give you halogen. Halogen will eat up all the paintings. I mean, it's bizarre, the minds. Yet, because of the government control, the first line, financial concerns. Yes, both and yes and no. Normally, the finance is very restricted, but then Mr. Gopal Gandhi's period, we could talk to the Prime Minister and get about 25-30 crores each. They were returned because the recipient directors, I'll put it bluntly, didn't want any trouble. Consumption capacity is also limited. The capacity to consume, suddenly persons whom you give 5 to 10, 10 crores per year, if you give them 30 crores, they'll not know how to handle it. Secretariat rules are there ruling the Indian Museum. It's as if it's a 10-to-5 secretariat that actually works on 11-to-4 mode. This is a 24-into-7 institution, where if unless somebody goes and checks the air conditioning at night, you don't know where you're landing up. Okay, Now, head-wise allocation may not be there. You might have a lot of money, but it's not specific head-wise. In other words, you can't have it under building head, you could have it under collection head. So these sort of things, tender processes for packaging and transport, it's a simple line. I've seen people lose their job because someone selected the best packager without going through the process. His enemies, who had made cuts from the substandard packages, made a complaint. Under the government rules, the man who took the initiative was at fault. He lost his job. Vigilance cases in Indian Museum, National Museum, etc. There will be none in Victoria because there's nothing done here for the 15 years support. Often, space constraints often present quite genuine. Extension of heritage properties is sacrilegious. We wanted an underground circulation space here without touching the top heritage. It was an excellent architectural plan. It's still there with Joint Toll, to find it out. VMH, Victor Memorial Hall's annexe goes for a 6. NM's phase 3, 20 years delay. Indian Museum's renovation, 6 years and still on. It will go on to 220th year maybe. CPWB, ASI, etc. problem. The problem is that we are bound by this CPWB, ASI. For 30 years I've been hearing that Victoria Memorial leaks and its leakage is supposed to be controlled by ASI. ASI DG comes and says, Victoria Memorial people don't cooperate. It goes on. Expertise. Specific expertise is a problem. Many gardeners. How many gardeners do you have, Jyotha? 100, 200? 200. Curators? 2. Now, every redisplay or exhibition is considered to be troublesome. Everyone. International practices are known to just a few. I think about 7-10 of your guys go international practices. Expert trainings are started with the British Museum, which Amarjit mentioned. So we will soon have a pool of people who will be pushing them forward. The idea is to create a demand pool. Joint exercises are good for updating. We used to insist on joint exercises with British, with the Germans, with the French and others, so that when they come and hold their exhibition and they do their framing, you pick the last best tactics at that point of time. And of course, we have problems, cultural problems. Guest curators are viewed suspiciously. Reforms will take time to fructify, but the only good thing is it's on. Inventory digitization, the third problem, has started in VMH and all museums. Registers are normally handwritten and not updated. This is when I joined in 2008. Digitization is finally on, thank God. Each museum will take its own time. You will take, I think, 2 years. 2 years. National Museum may take another 3 years. But then to get it in the public domain, that means tag them along with photographs and put them out for display, may take another 3 years, but it's on. Registers and physical verification. You know, the National Museum is such an obnoxious place at times. When somebody made up a charge, I retired in a particular gallery, I asked them, how long will they take to make over, take over charge? They said, 7 years. I said, what happens if the person dies? They won't die. No, in other world museums, the collection belongs to the registrar and you simply take over because you have electronic radio frequency RFS systems. Now, open access digital database with metadata, this is what we want. Solution in 2 to 3 years, most probably. E-registers, RFS, to track movements. It's like libraries we have. When you move a book from a place to place, you don't need to sign a register. It's dipped up on the sensor. Now, thank God we could all get them on Jatan. I think all of you are working on that one software. That took 2 years of discussion. But you see, this extra caution hasn't stopped theft, only hinders genuine display. Leadership, acute problem all over. Professional museologists are very few. Very few professional museologists. Museology was valued low. What happened is when culture and education got separated, education went up like a rocket and professors salaries and scales and other emoluments started jumping up, which is a very good thing to have happened in the society. But where supporting services like library, archivists, conservators, museums were concerned, they started taking a dip. I said, so it was, but what about advanced studies like JNU's A&A? A&A means art and aesthetics. Happy place. That's meant for Christies and Sotheby's. Who's going to come to museums from here? One guy will come back and do a body in Indian art and then go back. It's not meant for them. Bureaucrats fill in the gap, often reluctantly and mostly part-time. Along with three other duties, if he's made a museum director, he just signs the vouchers. So, rare exceptions can do wonders. I know of at least one bureaucrat who's done wonders. Venu Arun, Venu in National Museum, in 1 year has changed the face of it. He's one of the most attached bureaucrats in Delhi. Academicians fill in the gap, but they will still need specialization. I know of academicians who work for 18 years without learning specialization. Exposure and most aptitude. Visionaries. Now, this is one. Let's look at the other museums to start with. Hans Sloane, 1753, when the British Museum starts. Franks of the British Museum. Joseph Henry, Smithsonian. Wallich, the guy who built the Indian Museum, 1814. Grace Morley, she was invited by Pandit Nehru to take over the National Museum. When I wanted a foreigner to take over the National Museum, I had Parliament questions. Thing. L.P. Sihari, he was brought in from New York in the National Museum. Rakhal Das Banerjee, which very few people know, R.D. Banerjee was actually a curator in Chhatrapati Shivaji, Prince of Wales Museums. Sihari got into trouble. He challenged the system. Stimulus.